and make mention in the book of the Prophet Idris. We raised him to a very high level.
Idris alayhi salam was the first to take up arms against another army, to fight against injustice.
And he is the first man to ever write with the pen.
Indeed, he was very truthful and he was a prophet.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala amma ba'd.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen after Adam, the son of Adam, Shayth.
And from Shayth he had Anush, was one of his sons.
Who carried out his mission after him. Then after him his son Kin'an.
From there was Mihlail. And from Mihlail was Yarid or Yarid,
who took charge of his mission. And here the Quran, the next man or the son that came after him, the Quran mentions him. His name is Idris alayhi salam.
Idris was born at the time of Adam.
He was born when Adam alayhi salam was 840 years old.
So Idris met Adam and Adam met Idris. Idris is the sixth grandson of Adam.
In biblical terms, ancient names, he was called Enoch. He learned from Adam alayhi salam, he learned from Shayth alayhi salam.
And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said Idris was a prophet.
He was very good looking, he was very calm, he had a full grown beard. And he spoke very, very clearly. He was very patient.
Idris alayhi salam was tall in stature, 60 cubits tall. And when he walked, his footsteps were long. They were big footsteps. They were similar to the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he walked calmly. He spoke very little. That if ever he wanted to speak, he would speak something beneficial, words of wisdom, or he would be silent. And when he walked, it was not his nature to constantly look upwards. He used to look downwards, like a person who constantly was thinking. So he'd walk and he would think a lot, ponder a lot, contemplate a lot.
And he is the first man to ever write with the pen. So writing before Idris did not exist until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Idris how to write. And Idris alayhi salam is the one that taught people how to write.
He came as a prophet not to stop people from shirk or to call them to the correct information, but rather to help stop and call people away from acts of corruption which they knew were corruption, away from their desires, as we know, such as zina and the act of killing.
The people of that time were all upon Tawheed.
But they were committing many sins and ignorance was spreading among them. He strove so hard and he spread the message and reminded people so much to bring them back to the straight path.
When he saw the corruption spreading, especially among the people of Qabil, and that corruption is spreading even within the people of Idris, so Idris alayhi salam declared war against the corruption. The first prophet and messenger to call for jihad, fighting in the path of Allah, was Idris alayhi salam. And he prepared an army of horsemen and people walking, fighting against the people of Qabil and the corruption of the people of Qabil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to Idris alayhi salam.
Allah says, and mention in the book, in the Quran, Idris. He was a truthful prophet. And we raised him high in the heaven. What is meant when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we raised him high in the heavens?
Abdullah ibn Abbas once asked Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu ta'ala anhuma about this verse, and we elevated him a high position. He asked him, what's this about Idris? So Ubay ibn Ka'ab said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Idris one day
that every day your deeds are equivalent to the good deeds of everybody else on the face of the earth.
Over his own deeds, over his own rewards, over the good deeds of Idris, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also give him the rewards of all the people living at the time of Idris.
With simple calculation, Sayyidina Idris said, if that is the case, then if I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me a longer life, I would be able to accumulate more good deeds.
So he had a friend from the angels and he spoke to this friend. why don't we speak to the angel of death? Let's see what he has to say. To say, look, just try and see if you can seek permission to prolong a little bit. So the angel says, look, that is a matter that is decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, there's no harm in trying. Come, you ride on my wing and let's go.
So Idris alayhi salam went on the back of this angel and flew with him all the way to the heavens.
He crossed the first heaven, he crossed the second heaven, he crossed the third heaven. When he got to the fourth heaven,
they met the angel of death, who was descending down to the earth.
So this angel told the angel of death that Idris is asking that if he could make him live longer. So this angel of death said, where's Idris?
Then this angel said, he is with me, he is also on the fourth heaven. Then Malakul Maut said, Subhanallah.
So the angel told him, what's amazing? He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered me to take the soul of Idris in the fourth heaven. And I wondered how I'm going to do this. And subhanallah, Idris came with one intention. Angel of death came with another. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only happened what he wills.
This angel, speaking with the angel of death, looked on his back and saw that Idris has already passed away, and elevated him to a very high level. Nobody passed away in that level except Sayyidina Idris.
And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam confirms in Sahih al-Bukhari that when he went up for Mi'raj, he met Idris alayhi salam in the fourth heaven.
After the death of Idris, corruption started to increase even more and more and more. And people still believing in one Lord, Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal the Most High, Allah Azza wa Jal the Most Greatest, Allah Azza wa Jal the Most Strongest. So after the death of Adam, all the way up to 1,000 years, 10 centuries, as the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, people just worshipping one Lord, believing in one Lord. They believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that 1,000 years, that's when changes start to take place. It became a big gap between Idris and the next prophet and messenger being sent. Few centuries, no prophet, no messenger. These prophets and messengers had very righteous, God-fearing, obedient followers. And when the prophet went, people started to look up to those followers. Respected followers, ulama, salihin, scholars, righteous people. People used to respect them.
There were five very, very righteous individuals. And their names were Wad, Suwa', Yaghuth, Ya'uq, and Nasr.
And at the time of Idris, when they had a problem, they used to go to Idris. After Idris, they started to go back to those righteous people. After the death of the righteous people, what happened?
After they passed away, Shaitan seized the opportunity and now he begins his mission. He starts off by whispering in their minds, in the minds of the people.
Shaitan said to them, you know, what a wonderful person you are. What a wonderful. So Shaitan came and he grieved. Now you've got to look at the Shaitan's tactics here. We should have a remembrance for this person. So how are you going to have a remembrance for this person if we don't quickly make something that reminds us of this person? Look, we need to do this. We need to remember good people like this and honor them. We need to do this.
I've got a good idea for you. Why don't we get a rock? Just a rock. As a simple. Maybe just looking at that rock will remind us about those good days. So some people at that time, it's acceptable. There's nothing wrong and maybe a good thing. We're not doing anything wrong. Still believe in Allah Azza wa Jal. Worshipping. We're not going to worship this rock. Just something to remind us of this righteous man. So people accepted that. And that generation that accepted this, they were wise enough not to fall into a deeper hole than that.
Now Shaitan is very patient. He's got a plan. He sows the seed and he goes away. So he waited for that generation to pass.
When the next generation came, he said, you know, you're the grandchildren of these figures that went. Ah, what great grandfathers you had. You know these pictures, what you should do? You should take them and we should honor them more. Respect them by carving out certain, you know, stones out of their shape of these heads.
So they start to design and make out of the dust and mud and make out of rocks figures of human beings.
When that generation passed and people forgot why exactly they had made those statues, he went to the next generation and said, you know, your forefathers, you don't know what they used to do. They used to worship these idols. These are statues. This is what brought them goodness.
This rock is a symbol of wood. And this rock is a symbol of Sawar. And this rock is a symbol of Yaghuth.
He said, whenever they saw these idols, they worshipped the idols, so they became good people and goodness came in their direction.
So after the second generation, third generation, people start to worship these rocks and believe that these rocks will get them closer to Allah.
So the younger children who saw their parents going and sitting and making prostration and making dua towards the statues thought, you know, these are our gods. These are our gods. And they started to finally worship the statues. They completely forgot about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they started to worship these five idols.
And that's how the shirk started to spread and the shirk took over the world.
Now this was the point when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the first Rasul, Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam.
Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahu bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayhi.